We refuse to believe that our insufficient funds and the great hopes of the security of Boston. This is no time when David and the luxury of cooling off are to take the tranquilizing drug of gradualism. Now is the time to make real the promises of democracy. Now is the time to rise from the dark and desolate valley of segregation to the sunlit path of racial justice. Now is the time to lift our nation from the quicksand of racial injustice to the solid rock of brotherhood. Now is the time to make justice a reality for all of our children. It would be fatal for the nation to overlook the urgency of the moment. This sweltering summer of the Negro's legitimate discontent will not pass until there is an invigorating autumn of freedom and equality. 1963 is not an end, but a beginning. Those who hoped that the Negro needed to blow off steam and will now be content we'll have a rude awakening if the nation returns to business as usual.
Amen. You've been too long, okay? It's not just whites, it's everybody. Don't come to talk about it.
There will be neither rest nor tranquility in America till the Negro has granted his citizenship rights. A whirlwind, the revolt will continue to shake the foundations of our nation until the bright day of justice emerges. That is something that I must say to my people who stand on the one threshold which leads them to the palace of justice. In the process of gaining our rightful place, we must not be guilty of wrongful deeds. Let us not seek to satisfy our thirst for freedom by drinking from the cup of bitterness and hatred. We must forever conduct our struggle on the high plane of dignity and discipline. We must not allow our creative protest to degenerate into physical power. Day and again, we must rise to the majestic height of leading physical force with soul force. The marvelous new militancy which has engulfed the Negro community must not lead us to a distrust of all white people. For many of our white brothers, as evidenced by their presence here today, have come to realize that their destiny is tied up with our destiny. They have come to realize that their freedom is inextricably bound to our freedom. We cannot walk alone. As we walk, we must make a pledge that we shall always march ahead. We cannot turn back. There are those who are asking the devotees of civil rights, when will you be satisfied? We can never be satisfied as long as the Negro is the victim of the unspeakable horrors of police brutality. We can never be satisfied. As long as our body is heavy with the fatigue of travel, cannot gain lodging in the motels of the highways and the hotels of the city. We cannot be satisfied. Long as the Negro's basic mobility is from a smaller ghetto to a larger one. We can never be satisfied as long as our children are stripped of their selfhood and robbed of their dignity by signs standing for Christ only. We cannot be satisfied as long as the Negro in Mississippi cannot vote and the Negro in New York believes he has nothing for which to vote. No, no, we are not satisfied and we will not be satisfied until justice rolls down like water and righteousness like a mighty stream.
Jesus,
this Lord, this Lord. I am not mindful that some of you have come here out of great trials and tribulations. Some of you have come fresh from narrow jail cells. Some of you have come from areas where your friends quest for freedom. Left you battered by the storms of persecution, staggered by the winds of police brutality. You have been the veterans of creative suffering, continue to work with a faith that honor and suffering is redemptive. Go back to Mississippi. Go back to Alabama. Go back to South Carolina. Go back to Georgia. Go back to now to go back to the slums and ghettos of our northern cities, knowing that somehow this situation can and will be changed. Let us not wallow in the valley of despair. I say to you today, my friend, or even though we face the difficulties of today and tomorrow, I still have a dream. It is a dream deeply rooted in the American dream. I have a dream that one day this nation will rise up, live out the true meaning of its dream. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. I have a dream that one day on the red hills of Georgia, sons of former slaves and the sons of former slave owners will they be able to sit down together at the table of brotherhood. I have a dream. One day, even the state of Mississippi, a state sweltering with the heat of injustice, sweltering with the heat of oppression, be transformed into an oasis of freedom and justice. I have a dream. My poor little children, one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream today. I have a dream that one day, down in Alabama with this vicious racist, with this governor, having his lips dripping with the words of his and qualifications. One day right now in Alabama, little black boys and white girls would be able to join hands with little white boys and white girls as sisters and brothers. I have a dream today. Will be able to, you are everyone be able to work together, to pray together, to struggle together, to go to jail together, to stand up for freedom together, knowing that we will be free one day. This will be the day. This will be the day when all of us will be able to sing with new meaning, I come to see you. We land of liberty if we are saved. And where my fathers died, land of the pilgrims died. From every mountainside, let freedom ring. And if America is to be a great nation, this must become true. So let freedom ring. From the prodigious hilltops of New Hampshire, let freedom ring. From the mighty mountains of New York, let freedom ring. From the heightened Alleghenies of Pennsylvania, let freedom ring. From the snow-capped Rockies of Colorado, let freedom ring. From the provincial slopes of California, but not only that, let freedom ring. From Stone Mountain of
Georgia,
let freedom ring. From Lookout Mountain of Tennessee, let freedom ring. From every hill and mole hill of Mississippi, from every mountainside,
yes, Jesus, Lord.
Let freedom ring, and when this happens, when we allow freedom ring, when we let it ring from every city, from every hamlet, from every state, and every city, we will be able to speed up that day when all of the children, black men and white men, Jews and Gentiles,
yes, Lord. Yes, Jesus,
will be able to join hands,
yes, Lord.
And singing the words of the old Negro spiritual. Free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, we are free at last.
Thank you very kindly, my friend. Listen to Ralph Abernathy and his eloquent and generous introduction, and then thought about myself, I wondered who he was talking about. It's always good to have your closest friend and associate to say something good about you. And Ralph Abernathy is the best friend that I have in the world. I'm delighted to see each of you here tonight, in spite of a storm warning. You reveal that you are determined to go on anyway. Something is happening, and men said something is happening in our world. And you know, if I was standing at the beginning of time with the possibility of taking a kind of general and panoramic view of the whole of human history up to now, and the Almighty said to me, Martin Luther King, which age would you like to live in? I would take my mental flight by Egypt.
Jesus.
I would watch God's children in their magnificent trek from the dark dungeons of Egypt through a rubber across the Red Sea through the wilderness on toward the Promised Land. And in spite of its magnificence, I wouldn't stop there. I would move on by Greece and take my mind to Mount Olympus. And I would see Plato, Aristotle, Socrates, Euripides, and Aristophanes assembled around the Parthenon. Around the Parthenon as they discuss the great and eternal issues of reality, but I wouldn't stop there. I would go on even to the great heyday of the Roman Empire. And I would see developments around there through various emperors and leaders. But I wouldn't stop there. I would even come up to the day of the Renaissance and get a quick picture of all that the Renaissance did for the cultural and aesthetic life of man, but I wouldn't stop there. I would even go by the way that the man for whom I'm named had his habitat. And I would watch Martin Luther as he tacks his 95 theses on the door at the Church of Wittenberg, but I wouldn't stop there. I would come on up even to 1863 and watch the vacillating president by the name of Abraham Lincoln finally come to the conclusion that he had to sign the Emancipation Proclamation, but I wouldn't stop there. I would even come up to the early 30s. See a man grappling with the problems of the bankruptcy of his nation. With an eloquent cry that we have nothing to fear but fear itself, but I wouldn't stop there.
Yes, Jesus.
Strangely enough, I would turn to the Almighty and say, if you allow me to live just a few years in the second half of the 20th century, I will be happy. Well, that's a strange statement to make because the world is all messed up. The nation is sick. Trouble is in the land, confusion all around. That's a strange statement. But I know somehow that only when it is dark enough can you see the star.
Yes, Jesus, have mercy.
And I see God working in this period of the 20th century.
Say so, Reverend King. Say so.
In a way that men in some strange way are responding. Something is happening in our world. The masses of people are rising up. And wherever they are assembled today, whether they are in Johannesburg, South Africa, Nairobi, Kenya, Accra, Ghana, New York City, Atlanta, Georgia, Jackson, Mississippi, or Memphis, Tennessee, the cry is always the same. We want to be free.
That's all. That's Jesus.
Another reason that I'm happy to live in this period is that we have been forced to a point where we are going to have to grapple with the problems that men have been trying to grapple with through history, but the demands didn't force them to do. Survival demands that we grapple with. Men for years now have been talking about war and peace. Now, no longer can they just talk about it. It is no longer a choice between violence and non-violence in this world. It's non-violence or non-existence. That is where we are today. Also in the human rights revolution, if something isn't done and done in a hurry, to bring the colored peoples of the world out of their long years of poverty, their long years of hurt and neglect, the whole world is doomed. Happy that God has allowed me to live in this period, see what is unfolding. And I'm happy that He's allowed me to be in ministry. I can remember when Negroes were just going around, as Ralph has said, so often scratching where they didn't itch and laughing when they were not tickled. That day is all over. We mean business now, and we are determined to gain our rightful place in God's world. And that's all this whole thing is about. We aren't engaged in any negative protests and in any negative arguments with anybody. We are saying that we are determined to be men. We are determined to be people. We are saying, that we are God's children. And if we are God's children, we don't have to live like we are forced to live. Now, what does all of this mean in this great period of history? It means that we've got to stay together.
Amen. We all got to stay together.
We've got to stay together and maintain unity. You know, whenever Pharaoh wanted to prolong the period of slavery in Egypt, he had a favorite formula for doing. What was that?
Whipping.
He kept the slaves fighting among themselves.
That's right.
But whenever the slaves get together,
yes, Lord,
something happens in Pharaoh's court. And he cannot hold the slaves in slavery. When the slaves get together, that's the beginning of getting out of slavery.
Amen. That's true. Say so, Reverend. Say so.
Now let us maintain unity. Secondly, let us keep the issues where they are. The issue is injustice. The issue is the refusal of Memphis to be fair and honest in its dealing with its public servants, who happened to be sanitation workers. Now we've got to keep attention on that. That's always the problem with a little violence. You know what happened the other day, and the press dealt only with the window breaker. I read God. They very seldom got around to mentioning the fact that 1,300 sanitation workers are on strike and that Memphis is not being fair to them and that Mayor Loeb is in dire need of a doctor. They didn't get around to that.
Watch again.
again, if he's got to march again, in order to put the issue where it is supposed to be. Wants everybody to see the now 1,300 of God's children here suffering. Sometimes going hungry, going through dark and dreary nights, wondering how this thing is going to come out. That's the issue. We've got to say to the nation, we know how it's coming out. When people get caught up with that which is right, and they are willing to sacrifice for it, that is no stopping point short of victory. We aren't going to let any base stop. We are masters in our nonviolent movement in disarming police forces. They don't know what to do. I've seen them so often. I remember in Birmingham, Alabama, we were in that majestic struggle there. We would move out of the 16th Street Baptist Church day after day. By the hundreds, we would move out. Bill Connor would tell them to send the dogs for us. And they did come. We just went before the dogs singing, ain't gonna let nobody turn me around.
Amen. That's right.
Bill Connor next to me, turn the fire hose on. If I said to you the other night, Bill Connor didn't know history. He knew a kind of physics that somehow didn't relate to the trans physics that we knew about. That was the fact that there was a certain kind of fire that no water could put out. We went before the fire hose. We had known water. If we were Baptists or some other denomination, we had been immersed. If we were Methodists or some other, we had been sprinkled, but we knew water. That couldn't stop us. That went on before the dogs, and we would look at them, and we'd go on before the water hoses, and we would look at it. We just go on singing over my head, I see freedom in there. Then we'd be thrown in the paddy wagon. Sometimes we were stacked in there like sardines in a can. They would throw us in, and old bull would say, take them off. They did, and we were just going in the paddy wagon singing, we shall overcome. Every now and then we get in jail and we see the jailer looking through the window, being moved by our prayer, being moved by our words and our song. There was a power there which Bull Palmer couldn't adjust it. So we ended up transforming bull into a steel, and we won our struggle in Birmingham. We've got to go on in Memphis just like that. I call upon you to be with us when we go out Monday. How about injunction? We have an injunction and we are going into court tomorrow morning to fight this illegal, unconstitutional injunction. All we say to America is be true to what you say on paper.
That's right.
China or even Russia or any totalitarian. Maybe I could understand some of these illegal injunctions. Maybe I can understand the demands of certain basic First Amendment privileges because they have committed themselves to that over that. Somewhere I read of the freedom of assembly. Somewhere I read of the freedom of speech. Somewhere I read of the freedom of press. Somewhere I read that the greatness of America is the right to protest for rights. A water hose has turned us around. We aren't going to let any injunction turn us around. You're going on. We need all of them. You know what's beautiful to me? See all of these ministers of the gospel. It's a marvelous picture.
Yes, Lord. Thank God, minister.
Who is it that is supposed to articulate the longings and aspirations of people more than the preacher? Somehow the preacher will have a kind of fire set up in his bone. And whenever injustice is around, he must tell it. Somehow the preacher must be an aimless. When God speaks, who can but prophesy? And with Amos, let justice roll down like waters and righteousness like a mighty stream. Somehow the preacher would say with Jesus, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me. He's anointed me to deal with the problems of the poor. I want to commend the preacher under the leadership of these noble men, James Lawson. One who has been in this struggle for many years. He's been to jail struggling. He's been kicked out of Vanderbilt University for this struggle, but he's still going on fighting for the rights of his people. And Ralph Jackson, Billy Kyle, I could just go right on down the list. Time will not permit, but I want to thank all of them. And I want you to thank. Because so often preachers aren't concerned about anything but themselves. I'm always happy to see a relevant ministry. It's all right to talk about long white robes over yonder and all of its symbolism. But ultimately, people want some suits and dresses and shoes to wear down here. It's all right to talk about streets flowing with milk and honey. But God has commanded us to be concerned about the slums down here and his children who can't eat three square meals a day.
Amen.
It's all right to talk about the news on the one day. God's preacher must talk about the new New York. The new Atlanta, the new Philadelphia, the new Los Angeles, the new Memphis, Tennessee. This is what we have to do. Now, the other thing we have to do is this. Always anchor our external direct action with the power of economic withdrawal. And we are poor people. Individually, we are poor when you compare us with white society in America. We are poor. Never stop yet. That collectively, that means all of us together, collectively we are richer than all the nations in the world, with the exception of mine. You ever think about that? After you leave the United States, Soviet Russia, Great Britain, West Germany, France, I can name others, American Negro collectively is richer. And most nations of the world, we have an annual income of more than $30 billion a year, which is more than all of the exports of the United States and more than the national budget. That's power right there, if we know how to prove it. We don't have to argue with anybody. We don't have to curse and go around acting bad with our words. We don't need any bricks and bubbles. We don't need any. We just need to go around to these stores and to these massive industries in our country. Say, God sent us by here to say to you that you're not treating his children right. And we've come by here to ask you to make the first item on your agenda fair treatment where God's children are concerned. Now, if you're not prepared to do that, we do have an agenda that we must follow. And our agenda calls for withdrawing economic support from you.
Amen to that.
We're asking you tonight to go out and tell your neighbors not to buy Coca-Cola in them. Go by and tell them not to buy chilled fish milk. Tell them not to buy what is all the bread, Wonder Bread. What is all the bread, tell them not to buy hard. Jackson has said up to now, only the garbage men have been feeling pain. Now we must kind of redistribute the pain. We are choosing these companies because they have been planning their hiring policies. We are choosing them because they can begin the process of saying they are going to support the needs and the rights of these men who are on track. Then they can move on town, downtown, and tell Mayor Lowe to do what is right. And not only that, we've got a strength of black. I call upon you to take your money out of the banks downtown and deposit your money in Tri-State Bank. We want a banking movement in that. Go by the Savings and Loan Association. I'm not asking you something that we don't do ourselves in SBLC. Judge Brooks and others will tell you that we have an account here in the Savings and Loan Association from the Southern Christian Leadership Conference. We are telling you to follow what we are doing. Put your money there. We have six or seven black insurance companies here in the city of Memphis. Take out your insurance there. We want to have an insurance here. Now, these are some practical things that we can do. The to begin the process of building a great economic base. And at the same time, we are putting pressure where it really hurts. I ask you to follow through here. Now let me say as I move to my conclusion that we've got to give ourselves to this struggle until the end. Nothing would be more tragic than to stop at this point in Memphis. We've got to see it through. We have our hearts. We need to be there. It means leaving work. It means leaving school to be there. You're concerned about your brother. You may not be on track, but either we go up together or we go down together. Let us develop a kind dangerous unselfishness. One day a man came to Jesus. He wanted to raise some questions about the vital matters of life. Once he wanted to trick Jesus, show him that he knew a little more than Jesus knew and throw him off base. That question could have easily ended up in a philosophical and theological debate. But Jesus immediately pulled that question from midair, placed it on a dangerous curve between Jerusalem and Jericho. He talked about a certain man who fell among thieves. You remember that a Levite. The priest passed by on the other side. They didn't stop to help him. Finally, a man of another race came by. Got down from his beast, decided not to be compassionate by proxy. But he got down with him, administered first aid, helped the man in need. Jesus ended up saying this was the good man. This was the great man. Because he had the capacity to project the eye into the bound, to be concerned about his brother. Now, you know, we use our imagination a great deal to try to determine why the priest and the Levite didn't stop. At times we say they were busy going to a church meeting, an ecclesiastical gathering. They had to get on down to Jerusalem so they wouldn't be late for that meeting. At other times, we would speculate that there was a religious law that one who was engaged in religious ceremonials was not to touch a human body 24 hours before the ceremony. And every now and then we began to wonder.
Hi, God, I got one. Thank you for coming to my channel. Love you so much.
Down to Jericho, rather, to organize a Jericho Road Improvement Association. That's a possibility. Maybe they felt that it was better to deal with the problem from the causal root rather than to get bogged down with its individual effect. I'm going to tell you what.
God, a good one. I give you a wrench. You know you deserve it. Without you, I wouldn't be successful like that. Thank you so much, God. Love you so much, honey.
You see, the Jericho Road is a dangerous road. I remember when Mrs. King and I were first in Jerusalem. We rented a car and drove from Jerusalem down to Jericho. As soon as we got on that road, I said to my wife, I can see why Jesus used this as the
show me some love, guys, for this great speech. Martin Luther King, I'm going to hush my mouth because it's very important to me. Can I get a thumbs up, guys? Show me some love and I'll show it back. Drop your links, please. And I'll show somebody to get you some watch hours. I'll pay your playlist. Thank you so much for joining me. God bless everyone.
Every time you get down to Jericho, 15 or 20 minutes later, you're about 2,200 feet below sea level. That's a dangerous road. In the days of Jesus, it came to be known as the Bloody Path. You know, it's possible that the priest and the Levite looked over that man on the ground and wondered if the robbers were still around. It's possible that they felt that the man on the ground was merely faking. He was acting like he had been robbed and hurt in order to seize them over there, lure them there for quick and easy seats. So the first question that the priest asked, first question that the Levite asked was, if I stop to help this man, what will happen to me? But then the Good Samaritan came by, and he reversed the question. If I do not stop to help this man, what will happen to him? That's the question before you tonight. Not if I stop to help the sanitation worker, what will happen to my dog? Not if I stop to help the sanitation workers, what will happen to all of the hours that I usually spend in my office every day and every week as a pastor? Question is not, if I stop to help this man in need, what will happen to me? The question is, if I do not stop to help the sanitation workers, what will happen to them? That's the question. With a greater readiness. Let us stand with a greater determination. Let us move on. In these powerful days, these days of challenge, make America what it ought to be. We have an opportunity to make America a better nation. I want to thank God once more for allowing me to be here with you. You know, several years ago, I was in New York City autographing the first book that I had written. While sitting there autographing books, the minute black woman came up, the only question I heard from her was, "You, Martin Luther King," and I was looking down writing, and I said, "Yes." The next minute, I felt something beating on my chest. Before I knew it, I had been stabbed by this Dominican woman. I was rushed to Harlem Hospital. It was a dark Saturday afternoon. That blade gone through, and the x-rays revealed that the tip of the blade was on the edge of my aorta, the main artery. Once that's functioned,
oh my God,
you're drowned in your own blood. That's the end of you. It came out in the New York Times the next morning that if I had merely sneezed, I would have died. Well, about 4 days later, they allowed me, after the operation, after my chest had been opened and the blade had been taken out, move around in the wheelchair in the hospital. They allowed me to read some of the mail that came in from all over the states, the world, kind letters came in. I read a few, but one of them I will never forget. I had received one from the president and the vice president. I've forgotten what those telegrams said. I received a visit and a letter from the governor of New York, but I've forgotten what that letter said. There was another letter. It came from a little girl, a young girl, who was a student at the White Plains High School. And I looked at that letter, and I'll never forget it. Said simply, "Dear Dr. King, ninth grade student at the White Plains High School. She said, "While it should not matter, I would like to mention that I'm a white girl. I read in the paper of your misfortune and of your suffering. And I read that if you had sneezed, you would have died. I'm simply writing you to say that I'm so happy that you didn't sneeze. And I want to say tonight that I too am happy that I didn't sneeze, because if I had sneezed, I wouldn't have been around here in 1960. Students all over the South started sitting in at lunch hour. I knew that as they were sitting in, they were really standing up for the best in the American dream, taking the whole nation back to those great wells of democracy, which were dug deep by the founding fathers in the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution. If I had sneezed, I wouldn't have been around here in 1961. We decided to take a ride for freedom and ended segregation in interstate travel. If I had sneezed, I wouldn't have been around here in 1960. Negroes in Albany, Georgia decided to straighten their backs up. And whenever men and women straighten their backs up, they are going somewhere, because a man can't ride your back unless it is dead. If I had sneezed.
Hallelujah.
I had sneezed. In 1963, black people, Birmingham, Alabama, roused the conscience of this nation, brought into being the Civil Rights Bill. If I had sneezed, I wouldn't have had a chance later that year in August to try to tell America about a dream that I had had. If I had sneezed, wouldn't have been down in Selma, Alabama, see the great movement there. If I had sneezed, I wouldn't have been in Memphis, see a community rally around those brothers and sisters who are suffering. I'm so happy that I didn't sneeze. They were telling me, now it doesn't matter now. Really doesn't matter what happens now. I left Atlanta this morning, and as we got started on the plane, there were six of us. The pilot said over the public address system, "We're sorry for the delay, but we have Dr. Martin Luther King on the plane. And to be sure that all of the bags were checked, and to be sure that nothing would be wrong on the plane, we had to check out everything carefully. And we've had the plane protected and guarded all night." Then I got into Memphis, and some began to say the threats, or talk about the threats that were out. What could happen to me from some of our sick white brothers? But I don't know what will happen now. We've got some difficult days ahead. But it really doesn't matter with me now, because I've been to the mountain top. I don't mind. Like anybody, I would like to live a long life, longevity has its place. But I'm not concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will. And He has allowed me to go up to the mountain. I've looked over. I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you, but I want you to know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land. Lord, you have your mind on the Lord, on anything, on the Spirit, in the man.